This is Bruce DuMont. We continue with hour number two of Beyond the Beltway this evening, wherever you're listening from coast to coast. Nice to have you with us. Mike Miller is here. He is an economist from Western Washington University. Richard Porter is here. He is the Illinois Republican committeeman and has been for the last decade. Judith Sherwin is a pro-Trump conservative Republican attorney. And David Masiotra is with us. He is a liberal Democrat. But I want to ask one question to you, David, because you do not like or answer to the tune or identity as progressive. You don't like the use of the term progressive. Why?
That's correct. I joined Senator John Fetterman of Pennsylvania in distancing myself from that term and asking that people not associate me with it. There are several reasons, but you know, for the sake of time, I'll just give the straw that broke the camel's back, and that is the progressive tolerance and in some cases, outright encouragement and celebration of anti-Semitism since October 7th. So, you know, I'm proud to be called a liberal. I'm a Democrat. But as I wrote in an essay for The Ballwork, I will no longer stand aside progressives as long as they continue to stand aside anti-Semites and anti-Semitism more broadly.
Judith Sherwin, that's music to your ears.
I commend you. I don't know that that's the entire progressive movement, but I think that the far left in this country has lost their mind when it comes to this stuff. And I'm horrified at what has happened since mm-hmm. October 7th. And it's good to hear that.
Okay. We're going to go back to calls. David, listening to us in San Francisco. David, go ahead.
Yeah, Happy New Year, Bruce, and your guests. You know, when I was in kindergarten, I was taught that if Jimmy did something, it's not okay for Johnny to do it. So this so-called argument about whether or not Trump committed crimes and then immediately jumping on Joe Biden, that's a Jimmy did it, so Johnny can do it issue. That's about as lame as you can get. And to hear that a top lawyer in Chicago is pretending that that's a valid argument, Donald Trump has stolen property from the U.S. Taxpayers. It didn't matter if it was top secret or if it was Betsy Ross's knitting needles. He's took our stuff, and he's dragging on a case that should be as simple as property theft. And what's even worse, when you get into these documents in Mar-a-Lago, he's giving top secret clearance, security clearance, to a whole pack of lawyers, and they're going through every different item to determine their top secrecy value, as opposed to simply being the property of the U.S. government.
Okay, and, I think though that there's a real misunderstanding.
David, let's let Richard respond. Then we'll go back to you, but David, go to you first.
So the Presidential Records Act was...
Richard, by the way. This is Richard Porter.
It was passed in the 1970s, and it's built around the concept that the president has a property interest in the documents of his administration. Right. That's why you see for every president that they actually have libraries, and they are in their possession in those libraries and managed... By the government agency that's responsible for this, the archivists. And so the issue you have with Trump really isn't that he took something that wasn't his. Those are actually his documents. And for example, Obama's documents are in a strip mall in the Chicagoland area. You got, you know, tens of thousands of documents there. The issue is the management of the clearance of those documents. And again, the one person who can, you know, just by thinking about it or by expressing the view can declassify something is the President of the United States. The President is not bound by the classification. He can declassify it just by his actions. So, you know, I think we'll have to see how that case develops, but the issue in that case is not a property issue. The issue is what was the standard of whether or not those things were actually declassified and whether they're properly handled.
David in San Francisco, last word to you. Go ahead.
Well, there's a lot of hokum to what was just said, because Donald Trump also had down there a whole bunch of ancient Israeli artifacts. If I remember right, they were oil burners. and he hid them for years as well. So the guy is an outright thief. And again, these were our property.
David, let me stop you. Last word to you, but I want you to answer this question, because your position represents about 75 or 80 million people in this country. People that do not want Donald Trump to be reelected. I think I could honestly say you don't want him reelected. Now, my question to you is, if Donald Trump is reelected, how will you react?
As I would if a thief got into position of power. If you go into the history of Donald Trump from the very beginning, he was a thief.
Why, David, listen, and I'm going to give you one more chance to answer the question. If 75 to 80 million people might believe Donald Trump, and 75 or 80 million people might believe Joe Biden, if Joe Biden beats Donald Trump, how are you going to feel? What do you say to the 75 million people who think that Donald Trump is brilliant?
Personally, I don't believe that he's going to win the election. So that's a dubious question.
It's not a dubious question, but you're from San Francisco, so I think I know where your politics are coming from. Thank you for calling. I know you're a regular listener. Thank you for calling tonight. Now, my question to the rest of our discussion this evening is the future of the Republican Party. We are debating it right now. I asked the question at the beginning of the program. And I want to begin with you, Mike Miller, because I know where our guests in studio stand on this issue. But do you have a favorite as to who you would like to be the nominee of the party this year?
Because I would like things to get done. Prefer that Ron DeSantis be the nominee. Okay,
that's right.
Because I'm convinced that when Mr. Trump does win, and I think that he has a very good chance of winning, that he will be tied up in problems for the entire 4 years. The left, the media, everyone will go to whatever lengths necessary to allow him to do nothing. That was pretty much true during his first 4 years. I very much support many of Mr. Trump's positions. I like America First. He has me convinced that maybe the trade deals that he came up with against China were a good idea. They weren't economically, but they were politically. Mr. Trump.
Thank you.
But I want the governor to be the
Governor DeSantis. When we come back, we're going to hear from our other guests and how they feel. They differ. I'm Bruce DuMont. Back shortly. Back on the air, and we are now going to go to Richard Porter because he has an opinion as to who he would like to be president of the United States.
Yeah, I'm with Mr. Miller. I think that DeSantis would be by far the finest president we could get out of our field. I think he's a man that's demonstrated in Florida an ability to get things done in a way that's kind of shocking. I mean, just how they got the bridge built in 2 days after the hurricane blew it out, to me, epitomizes a man who's able to get things done. He has a very clear conservative vision. I think he offers us an opportunity to achieve some real change in Washington, D.C. if we can rally around him as an alternative. You get the benefits of the Trump policy without all the drawbacks of Donald Trump's behavior.
Now, Judith Sherwin, tell us why you're for Donald Trump. Because you are the only identified Trump supporter on the panel this evening.
I see that. Let me say this about Ron DeSantis. I agree. He did like miraculous work after the hurricane, but everybody wanted him to do that miraculous work. I don't see that Ron DeSantis can withstand the kind of hurricane that would be directed in his direction should Trump disappear off the face of the earth tomorrow. And God, I hope he doesn't, because I don't think that there is anybody who has the strength to be able to deal with what's going on in Washington. I think that when Trump first came into office, he tried to accommodate what he was doing with what he calls the deep state, okay? They weren't going to have it. He had people who were absolutely opposing him every place, even the ones he put into office. It took him at least 2 years to get rid of all of that and to figure it out. It's a learning curve, okay? But the guy is very bright.
So you don't think it will happen again?
I do not. I think that he knows what he wants. I think he knows how to get it. I think he knows who he can use to help him. He went through those first 4 years.
Are you worried?
And he let me finish, Bruce. Okay. Since he accomplished a lot of things with all of that stuff going on, okay?
I agree.
And so, it's going to go on again. There's no question.
Are you worried that he will spend more time on defense than on offense?
No, I'm not. This guy is they talk about him like he's three-dimensional chess and all that stuff. He's a very bright guy, okay? And people don't want to agree with that. Oh, his vocabulary isn't very good, and he makes all these grammatical errors and spelling errors. I mean, I think, quite frankly, he does that on purpose, okay? He is a very bright man. He didn't build that company by being stupid, okay? So it took him a while. He saw government from the outside.
Okay.
He knew how to deal with it from the outside. Now he knows how to deal with it from the inside.
I do think it's clear he is a brilliant guy. He has a masterful touch with people. I think he's got charisma. I think he's learned a lot. I think he didn't learn enough in the first 3 years to clear out his NSC, for example, that was filled with people that were filled with Trump derangement syndrome. That's mm-hmm. the reason why he was impeached.
Right.
And, I think that they need to act in a way recognizing that the people that oppose him are kind of crazy. And so, right.
Okay. We have heard from
three
guests who've all said who they would like as the Republican nominee. I want to turn to David Masiotra, David. And my question to you is, of all the potential Democratic nominees, who is your preferred nominee for president this year?
You mean the declared ones or some imagining work? Imagining?
All of them.
Well, I wish that Joe Biden was not running for re-election.
Okay.
I would like to see a Democratic primary with candidates like Governor Whitmer of Michigan, Governor Beshear of Kentucky. Some of these governors who are in purple states, or in Beshear's case, a red state, and have managed to build a great resume of achievement and attract support from a diversity of voters, and not just racial diversity, but I mean ideological diversity. And they're both younger, and they both have fresh ideas, and they're vibrant. And I think that potentially in 2028, we can see a great presidential race for this wonderful country, because we'll have young candidates on both sides, and we can get out of this trap of debating Trump and the documents and January 6th and all of this nonsense.
Is the president's age the thing that concerns you the most?
I don't know if it's what concerns me the most. He does appear frail, comparing the way he looks now to the way he looked 3-4 years ago is quite a shock, and it's a little alarming. He's an average president. He doesn't have a sense of the electorate. He doesn't have the support of many people, even in his own party. And on many important issues, he's failed to lead. That being said, obviously, as everyone could gather from my comments tonight, if the contest is between him and Donald Trump, I will cast a vote for Joe Biden.
And where would you put Kamala Harris in the list of would-be presidents?
I don't have any objections to Kamala Harris. You know, she's become this pinata that everybody likes to beat up on, but she hasn't had much of a role in the Biden administration, so it's really hard to evaluate her performance as vice president in that regard. She could use some improvement in her communication skills, but as we have seen with President George W. Bush, President Donald Trump, and President Joe Biden, having a Kennedy-esque mastery of oratory is not a prerequisite for performing competently as president. So I would be open to considering her if we had this imaginary hypothetical world where she was a contender in a robust primary.
To our Republicans, we have not talked about Nikki Haley. She's apparently doing very well in New Hampshire, and we'll see how well she does in Iowa. But go back to you, Mike Miller. You're for DeSantis, but what grades would you give Nikki Haley?
Boy, you know, that's tough because I don't want to say she sounds terrible. She's a zero to me. I just don't quite get her. I do not want her to be the nominee for the department for the
presidency
for the party. Now, if it were between her and Joe Biden, said it was, you know, Joe Biden versus Trump, he would go with Biden. I would go with Haley, but I see her as establishment. I think she's, unlike Mr. Trump, I don't think she's as much a America First. I think she is more willing to embrace war than Mr. Trump is. Mr. Trump's going to try to find solutions before we go to war. I'm not a fan.
Richard Porter, your response to Nikki Haley as a candidate.
I think Nikki's terrific. I view her as being less passionately conservative, intellectually conservative, as DeSantis is. So I think she would get less done in terms of changing the government. But I think, as a candidate, she's a delightful person. She's had some terrific experiences, and I think it's exciting to see her in the top tier. I just happen to think DeSantis would end up being a better president, and that's why I backed DeSantis so far.
Judy Sherwin, your thoughts?
I think Nikki Haley would be a catastrophe as president. I think it would be a return to the neocon. Let's go run off and fight a bunch of wars. Let's interfere over here. Let's interfere over there. Look, Vivek, who nobody talks about, who's quite exciting. Maybe a few years down the road, she left government, you know, basically a pauper, and now she's a millionaire because she's serving on the boards of all these military industrial complex companies. She's got definitely a warmonger. I won't call her a warmonger, but she definitely doesn't seem to have a problem with war. Okay. And playing with the toys that the people that she's worked for would like to play with. So I don't want to see her as president. Okay. I also don't think she has the strength to withstand the onslaught.
Okay, we've got David Mastriotto, you're waving your hand. You want to jump in on this assessment of Nikki Haley?
I was just going to say that, and perhaps this will doom Nikki Haley's chances if she receives a compliment from me on this panel, but she's an immensely impressive candidate. And speaking as a Democrat, if she was the Republican nominee, I would be convinced that Joe Biden would lose, that she would probably win handily against Joe Biden.
Well, the polls,
that doesn't mean everyone should support her, but that's just an interesting challenge to put to the Republicans.
Yep. Well, the big question that I think, when we get to that is, what happens if Donald Trump doesn't get the nomination? What happens to the Trumpsters? Where do they go? Do they go to DeSantis? Do they go Do they go to another person? Does Donald Trump go to a third party effort? What does he do? Because I agree with you. I think there's been a lot of certainly love lost between Donald Trump and DeSantis, probably less so with Nikki Haley, although that's increasing. And I think Vivek Ramaswamy may be a little bit too young to be the running mate. But I think if you ask Donald Trump if you had to ask him straight, I think he'd say he'd love Vivek Ramaswamy as a running mate. But it might be too much for the electorate to swallow. I'm Bruce DuMont, back shortly from Chicago. Bruce DuMont back, and Richard Porter, who's the Republican National Committeeman from Illinois, he has some news about Vivek in Illinois.
So Vivek did not file the paperwork necessary to qualify to be on the ballot in the Illinois primary, which I think is a significant fact. Illinois is a major state. And it just says he's taking a pass on this primary. I don't know how you can be a national candidate and not be on Illinois' ballot.
Do you know, because Illinois, there's other states in addition to Illinois, on the 19th of March. Do you know whether he has filed in any of the other states?
I don't know. Illinois has a high bar in terms of the number of signatures you need to obtain on the petitions in order to qualify. It's one of the hardest states in the union to qualify.
How come?
Pardon me?
How come?
Because the number of signatures you need to obtain in the petitions, it's just there's more work to be done. And plus, the law in Illinois, not surprisingly, being a machine state, is very arcane, very technical. The smallest little error can cause a petition to be disqualified. So it really benefits people that are in the profession full time, because they know the tricks of the trade. They know what mistakes can't be made. If someone comes from the outside and tries to get onto a ballot here, they need to hire a lawyer, and they need to understand how hard it is and how careful you have to be in order to qualify. Right.
Is everybody else qualified?
So far.
That's got to be challenged, perhaps.
The other folks that filed are Trump, DeSantis. They filed full slates of 102 delegates and alternate delegates. Nikki Haley filed, but she was about 15 alternate delegates short, so she filed with something like 87 people on the ballots. And the way it works in Illinois, you have a beauty contest at the top where you pick the name of the president you'd like to choose, and then you vote for actual delegates on a congressional district by congressional district basis. And there are, on the ballot in Illinois, there are three delegates spots for each congressional district, and three alternate delegates. And then there'll be 10 or 12 that are chosen at our state convention later in May. And that's usually going to the person that wins the beauty contest.
What's happening to Chris Christie?
Christie also filed, thank you, for he filed just under the deadline. People have not looked at his petitions yet. He did not have a full slate of delegates and alternates. And I think that he's probably the most vulnerable if people start challenging the delegates.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that, does he have a future in the party? Or is he pretty much the turd in the punch bowl?
Well, I mean, look, I mean, I think Chris has had, you know, a long and interesting career. He's a successful prosecutor, obviously a successful governor, ran into a scandal at the end. He was the first candidate last time to endorse Donald Trump. What people don't often know is that Chris Christie put Donald Trump's son-in-law's father
into jail.
Yeah. And so, you know, Chris was offered the vice presidency by Donald Trump, and then his children engineered a meeting with Mike Pence. They told him his plane was broken down, so he was forced to stay in Indianapolis overnight and have breakfast with him again. They had both a dinner and a breakfast because the plane was disabled. And they convinced him to go with Mike Pence instead. And so then Trump put him in charge of the transition. And then when he won, he threw him off the transition. So you have a lot of bad blood between Chris Christie and Donald Trump on a personal basis, in part because Trump's son-in-law,
Jared Kushner,
is not a fan. So I think Chris Christie will, you know, rise again in some other way, in some other fashion, and just see how the party develops. You know,
he could also go back, obviously, to be part of the panel on ABC, which, by the way, I watch a little bit of NBC, a little bit of CBS, a little bit of ABC, and a little bit of Fox, and a little bit of CNN. I have to say that ABC, which in my view at one time was, I think they were ahead of NBC and CBS when it came to fairness. Mm-hmm. I don't think that anymore. I think that the fact that they've got people on the air who are so, like Jonathan Martin, I mean, they are so, Jonathan Carl is, he's written two anti-Trump books, and yet every time the book comes out, it's a big splash on ABC. They make a big deal of it. Now he goes and gets women that think that Trump acted improperly on January 6th. He made a big deal of that. It seems to me that if you're watching ABC, you're going to get Jonathan Carl's perspective, which really I don't think is based on journalism accuracy or fairness, and primarily on fairness. So I used to be a big fan of ABC at the network level. I'm not anymore, primarily because, not because of George Stephanopoulos. I think although he showed his, you know, credentials here, you know, today in talking about Tennessee or Texas Representative Tony Gonzalez, he really pushed him pretty hardly. But I do believe that the way that Jonathan Carl treats the Trump campaign and covering campaign 2024 is really a disgrace. It's a disgrace to ABC. He should be spoken to, as they say.
Who's going to speak to him? I mean, they've got Trump deranged.
Well, Bob Iger. Someone should objectively, if they can do that, sit down and say, listen, here's our newscast. Is there something fishy about having someone who's written two anti-Trump books, who is your political guy who's on Sunday morning offering an assessment on the Trump campaign, and he's offering field reports during the week on ABC Network News? It's the same guy. And I just think that it's egregious. It's more egregious than what NBC and even
it's
what CBS
does. It's almost worse
does.
Than MSNBC in some ways.
Well, you know what? I must say, I don't watch MSNBC, so I can't say. And I don't watch CNN very often as well. It's pretty hard to stick with it.
Right.
Let's go to Edward in Tampa, Florida. Joins us. Go ahead, Tampa. You're on the air. Edward, are you there? Gary in Fort Wayne, Indiana, are you there?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Go ahead, Gary. You're on the air.
I was just calling about the statements that Governor Haley made about the Civil War. I thought the uproar was ridiculous. But I'm kind of shocked that nobody has identified the person who asked the questions. I can't believe he was in the middle of a bunch of reporters and nobody knows who this person is. He seemed like an obvious plant to me, but I don't really know. I just would like to know who asked this question and who was so indignant.
I don't know the answer to that question, and I do believe it was from a voter, not from a reporter.
Right.
That doesn't sound like a question that a reporter would ask.
I don't really know what the question was.
Well, the question basically, what were the causes of the Civil War? And she listed them primarily as a states' rights challenge, yeah. not as slavery. But again, it seems to me that Nikki Haley, given the fact that she's the former governor of South Carolina,
Fort Sumter.
Sorry, Sumter.
Yeah, that
might have something to do with her answer.
And also, the only politician who had the courage to stand up and say, let's take down the Confederate flag. I mean, that was a profile in courage. And also the way that she responded to the church shootings in Charleston. Mm-hmm. That was the only black-on-white crime of that year, as I recall, that didn't result in some sort of racial animus and rioting, because she handled it with dignity. She brought the victims' parents and family together, and they were all basically on the side of Governor Haley as she was trying to console what was going on in the field.
In that community.
And she was a Southern governor that stood up and did that. David, does she get a profile in Courage for that?
Yes, I agree. And I actually tell that story in my book, forgive the shameless plug.
That's
but,
okay.
Jesse Jackson is originally from Greenville, South Carolina, and she brought him in as an advisor during the Confederate flag kerfuffle and the aftermath of the Dylann Roof shooting. Mm-hmm. And I was actually in his office interviewing him once when she called him on the phone. And he had very nice things to say about her on those issues, although they disagreed on many other issues. I would say that to the caller suggesting that the questioner about the Civil War was a plant, this is dangerous. I've seen this a societal metamorphosis recently, in that we've gone from too much gullibility. About 20 years ago, people believed anything the government told them, anything the mainstream media reported, to now this conspiratorial mindset, this paranoia, in which everything's a plot or a plant, and that undermines faith and trust in institutions and in each other. And anyone who has studied democracy for a minute knows that some modicum of faith and trust in institutions and each other is important for the long-term survival of a democratic system.
I agree very much, and that's why, you know, as someone who said, admittedly, for decades, I gave great credit to ABC News. I thought ABC News was light years ahead of everybody else insofar as fairness and balance. It was the early days when George Will was a regular participant. I think that was a political decision that ABC News made, and it gave them an edge. They gave them an edge with conservative voters and even political pundits. But I'm just saying is that in recent years, I would just say that I think Jonathan Carl of ABC at the network level, he uses his personal animosity against Donald Trump in the writing of books and in the selection of stories about the campaign. I don't think he's fair. I don't think he's balanced. And I don't think he should be on ABC as their prime political guy. That's my opinion. Other than that, he looks good.
Great.
All right. On that note, we're going to.
No, I wasn't.
Go ahead.
I wasn't accusing you of having that mindset. I was accusing the caller who said that the question was a plant.
No, I understood that you were not accusing me. That would be obviously heresy. heresy from the guest. No, not. I'm only kidding. I'm Bruce DuMont, back shortly from Chicago. I'm back in our last segment of our broadcast this evening, and Mike Miller, I want to go to you because I mentioned that your frequent visit to this program on the first Sunday of every month really focuses on the big economic stories of the past month. And so as we begin 2024, what would your assessment of the economy be? Where is it strong? Where is it weak?
Yep. Thank you, Bruce. That's a great intro. You know, what's interesting is that Joe Biden, he came up as a response to MAGAnomics. He wanted to, or Trumponomics, he came up with Bidenomics. And he was convinced he could sell us that he has created this wonderful economy. And you know, what's interesting is if you look at it through the eyes of unemployment, we have full employment. So unemployment's not an issue. If you look at the number of jobs created, there's enough jobs being created that matches the demographic change of the U.S., which is a great thing. And also, if you look at it in terms of the growth of gross domestic product, it's right at potential or higher than potential, which is a really good thing. So you would wonder, why is it that Americans have almost across the board, including Democrats, rejected his portrayal of the economy as being so good. And some folks at the St. Louis Fed were trying to figure out what explains why the consumer confidence numbers are as low as they were, especially they were lower at the end of the pandemic than any time in the history that they've been keeping these data. And it all comes down to, of all things, real income, your income adjusted for inflation. And here's the big thing. In the 3 years since Biden took office, I did these calculations last night, average weekly earnings of Americans adjusted for inflation have fallen 5%. In the last 3 years of the Trump administration, they rose 8.4%. People were used to getting raises that actually meant something. Now they're getting raises that don't mean anything because of inflation. Inflation under Biden since 2021 has been a cumulative 17.2%. So everything is up 17% overall. Under Mr. Trump, in his last 3 years, it was only 5.5. So people were used to a little inflation. They did not like a lot of inflation.
So let me ask you a quick follow-up question, Mike.
Sure.
You said that there's three good things that Biden, the numbers are pretty good for Biden. So is it a matter of just he's not selling it right? Because you say there is positive news. I would assess that is there's positive news that Joe Biden would be selling to the American people, but they're not buying it.
But here's the problem. When the president tells you that things are going well, and in fact, economically, in terms of certain areas, they are. But when you get your paycheck and you go to the store and you can't buy as much as you did before, that's what matters to you,
right.
That, Bruce. That's what these economists at the St. Louis Fed found. These other matters, your real income falling, outweighs everything else. And then one other thing, there is the price of gasoline. Now, it should never be as important as it is. It is a relatively small part of everybody's budget. But Americans see gasoline prices in their faces every single day, and it matters to them. And under Trump in his last 3 years, the price of gasoline essentially went between 246 and 256, 10-cent difference, almost no change over the whole time. The price in January 2021 was 246. The price now, I looked it up last night, 309 across the country.
We've got about 10 months left now, okay? Look into your crystal ball and tell us the highs and lows. What's this road going to look like when we get together on the first Sunday in November?
I think that the economy has a relatively bright outlook. It looks like it has achieved what is called a soft landing, that the economy is going to get rid of some of the worst of the inflation without a recession. I think unemployment will be a little bit higher. I think GDP will be growing. So there'd be no reason that Mr. Biden can't say, I created some of this, though he has nothing to do with it. No president does. But the problem, of course, if he does nothing about the border, if the inflation does begin to spike up again and our real wages don't keep up, he can say everything he wants. But if when you and I go to the store and we see high prices and we can't buy as much as we used to, Americans are going to be pissed.
Hearing you say, Mike, is though there is the opportunity for him to sing a happy song in November.
Yes, I believe
if he knows how to package it right, there's some positive things that are not just BS.
That's
correct. How is he going to make the prices come down? I mean, he can't do that.
Trouble is he can't make them come down. It's actually the Fed, has gotten the rate of increase to fall. But those high prices is what people, you know, they look and they see a box of cereal and it just costs so much. Yeah. This is what people are responding to. Not that the fact that unemployment is at full employment and GDP is at potential.
I mean, it doesn't matter if you're at full employment, if you don't make enough money to go to the grocery store and buy you bought last week.
Judy, that's exactly what these economists were finding.
Yeah. Yeah,
sentiment should be stronger than it is. And the reason it is not is because of this real income problem.
Right.
And and Mr. Biden's got to wrap his, because how many times did he tell, inflation's not an issue? He hurt himself by essentially lying about it, by by poo-pooing it and say, oh, you people, you don't know what you're talking about. If he had any degree of sympathy for what we were going through out here, I think he would be in a much better position than he is. And
good point, Mike.
He's not a very good salesman.
Well, that's a good, again, if you're, David, as a Democrat, those are probably pretty good words coming from our economist.
Yeah, I actually agree with that, even the last part. Biden seems to act as if not talking about inflation is the best way to deal with it. Yeah. As if, you know, he doesn't mention it, people won't notice it, which is ridiculous. Can I risk losing your entire audience by asking Mike a philosophical question?
Quick question.
Don't people tend to overrate the influence presidents have on the national economy?
Absolutely. David, you're exactly right. I am one who believes that some presidents can set the tone. Ronald Reagan was one of those presidents.
I'm Matt Miller.
By making fundamental changes.
We are out of time. Mike Miller?
Presidents have nothing to do.
You get the last word on the program. David Mastriotra, thank you. Judith Sherwin, thank you. Vermeer, Richard Porter, thank you as well. Our thanks also to Fritz Goldman for his assistance in the production of this program. I'm Bruce DuMont. Good night from Chicago.